Women Who Take Your Breath Away, The Leslie Petrone Story by Julie Torres-Johnson. Published by Balboa Press. Narrated by Melanie Taylor. There are no coincidences. I view accidents of chance as planned and premeditated gifts that I'm free to accept or reject. Judith Knowlton. Introduction. My early life was riddled with accidents of chance that I refused to accept as premeditated gifts. Until one Sunday morning, my daughter Leslie interrupted my service with a call for help. That accident of chance became one of my greatest planned and premeditated gifts. Known to her friends as little because of her size, not her presence, which was luminous, Leslie spread love wherever she went. After a few months in ICU, while she was still strong enough to talk, Leslie reached out for my hand, looked deeply into my eyes, and whispered, "Mom, promise me that after I'm gone, you will live your dream." That dream? To write a book about my extraordinary, one-of-a-kind daughter and our 50-year journey through the world of cystic fibrosis. This is a story of love, discovery, growth, inspiration, pain, miracles, and ultimately, transcendence. If you look deeply into the palm of your hand, you will see your parents and all generations of your ancestors. You are the continuation of each of these people. Thich Nhat Hanh. Chapter 1. Leslie, who lived her life one day at a time, inherited her love of life from her dad's father, Grandpa Tony, who lived full out, without reservation. She had his wife, Grandma Josie, to thank for her strong life force. Josie ran for an hour each day until she was 85 and lived with clarity of mind until her passing at age 94. No doubt this contributed to the fact that at the time of her death, Leslie was the longest ever female survivor of cystic fibrosis in California. In addition to the qualities received from her paternal grandparents, Leslie inherited a strong, resilient spirit from my parents, Victor and Ramona. At the time of my birth, my father's physical disability made it impossible for him to work outside of the home. Consequently, he took care of the children, while my mother, who barely earned enough to put food on the table for our family, worked as a seamstress in a New York City sweatshop. Although Leslie's grandpa, Victor, had serious physical issues, like Leslie, he was able to rise above them. And following in his footsteps, Leslie's only intoxication in life became a deep sense of love and duty for her family. Her grandmother Ramona's contribution of resilience to Leslie came from her steady rise from seamstress to manager, floor lady, and eventually to owner of that sweatshop, which became a prosperous dress factory. Ramona and Victor's legacy enabled Leslie to develop such a strong sense of self that at the height of her disease, she was able to proclaim, "I may have cystic fibrosis, but cystic fibrosis doesn't have me." You are a child of the universe, no less than the trees and the stars. Buddha. Chapter 2. The year was 1961. Leslie's father and I had just graduated from college together and were living in a one-bedroom apartment in Flushing, Long Island. I was teaching high school English, and Russell was working as a sales rep for Ortho Pharmaceutics when our daughter, Leslie Kathleen Petrone, drifted into our lives. Her story began when I, a rather introverted teenager with little life experience, fell in love with her father, Russell Anthony Petrone. Despite being the only son of a minister, Russell had managed to squeeze as much life out of his otherwise dull preacher's kid existence as was possible. To say that Russell had been around the block a few times would be an understatement. Smoking was considered an unforgivable sin in his religion that believed, long before it was scientifically proven, that it caused lung cancer. So when Russell, who was in his senior year of high school, was caught smoking, he was immediately expelled from his boarding school in Massachusetts and sent home to the Upper Bronx in New York City. Committed to having his son finish high school, his father enrolled him at the Greater New York Academy in Woodside, Long Island, where I was beginning my sophomore year. You may recall the TV character The Fonz, played by Henry Winkler, on the television show Happy Days. The Fonz, with his black hair combed back in a duck's tail and his black leather jacket, seemed like a replica of Russell Petrone during our high school days. At 18, Russell was definitely more sophisticated than most of the students at my parochial high school. The scoop on him was that he was too worldly, a term used to define someone who had stepped away from the narrow path of our religion. Besides his charm and good looks, he was the only boy at my high school who had his own car, which was huge at the time. And to top all of that, he had a part-time job after school, which guaranteed that he had money to spend on his girlfriends. As a 15-year-old, serving as vice president of the student council and dating its president, it had never even occurred to me that Russell would be romantically interested in me, or, for that matter, that I could be enticed by his charm. However, all it took was a ride in his car after school one day, and we were engaged by my 17th birthday and married a year later. After years of trying to start a family to no avail, Russell and I were overjoyed when we finally became pregnant. Surrounded by love and anticipation, it seemed like everyone around us, family, friends, the high school students I taught, were looking forward to the birth of Leslie Kathleen, our first child. One day, in May of 1961, while teaching my American literature class, I experienced one of the sweetest surprises of my life. I had just introduced The Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne to my students when my classroom door suddenly flew open and a sea of senior high school girls rushed in. Two of them were carrying a large, beautifully decorated umbrella, which they placed on the floor in the back of the classroom. After each girl had placed her gift under it, they all faced the front of the room where I stood with a shocked expression and shouted, "Surprise!" And my first baby shower began. I can still see those happy, excited faces interrupting my class to celebrate Leslie in vitro and her proud mother-to-be. And I shall always be grateful for the love and thoughtfulness that touched both Leslie's and my soul that day. In fact, I believe that Leslie's spirit responded in kind to all the love and thoughtfulness that we received, because she never missed an opportunity to shower kindness and thoughtfulness on any of us. From the very beginning, Leslie was a trusting baby who would jump into any arms that reached out for her. She laughed often and extended her joy to others. In fact, those qualities became her lifelong hallmark. At the same time, however, Leslie had health challenges that began in early infancy. She had trouble digesting her food, was plagued with diarrhea, and suffered from frequent bouts of bronchitis. As a toddler, she developed a voracious appetite that was difficult to quench, yet she never gained enough weight for her size. Besides all of that, Leslie suffered from insomnia, so her dad and I developed all kinds of schemes to get her to fall asleep. Her crib stood next to our bed in our one-bedroom apartment, so her dad came up with the ingenious idea of tying a string from his big toe to Leslie's crib so he could rock her to sleep. And there were many nights when, still rocking her crib, he fell asleep long before she did. As a baby, Leslie loved riding in her Austin Healey. Car rides were the only thing that relaxed her enough to make her fall asleep. So at night, we often drove around our neighborhood for hours, with Leslie lying on a pillow between the front seats, where the hum of the engine put her blissfully to sleep, and kept her asleep until we got home and carefully transferred her to the crib. To say that Russell and I were sleep-deprived is an understatement. Leslie never took naps, nor fell asleep before 10 o'clock p.m. And since she started walking when she was only 10 months old, she would climb out of her crib at the crack of dawn and wake us up. I knew better than to try to get a few winks after she appeared at our bedside, because if I didn't jump up immediately, she would go exploring either around the house or in the neighborhood. Leslie, who was exceptionally small for her age, was the size of a normal 2-year-old when she was 3. One morning, when she was 3 years old, she appeared at my bedside at 5 o'clock a.m. I must have been extremely tired that morning because I closed my eyes again and fell sound asleep. Instead of waking me up again as she usually did, Leslie, who was always hungry, simply wandered down the hall to the kitchen and reached up to the refrigerator handle. Once she managed to open the door, she crawled inside. Unable to open the sealed food containers, she dropped to the floor, opened the front door, stepped outside, and walked over to our neighbor's backyard. Meanwhile, my neighbor, who had stepped out of his house for an early morning smoke, discovered Leslie standing beside his unfenced pool, petting his dog Smokey. Apprehensively, he walked toward her and said, "Hi, Leslie. What are you doing here so early? Your mother must be looking for you." Since she knew him well, she simply said, "I just came over to pet Smokey." Although Smokey was enjoying the attention, our neighbor panicked about the unfenced pool directly behind her. So, trying not to startle her, he moved slowly in her direction and asked, "Have you had your breakfast yet?" When Leslie moved her little head from side to side, he said, "Not yet? Then let's go home and get some." Meanwhile, back home, when I opened my eyes and realized that I had fallen back asleep, I jumped out of bed calling her name. "Leslie! Leslie, honey, where are you?" I ran to the kitchen where I found the refrigerator door open and sealed containers of food all over the floor. "She must be in the bathroom," I thought. Frantically calling her name, I ran down the hall toward the bathroom, but before I got there, the doorbell rang. Anxious and crazed with foreboding, I turned toward the front door and opened it, and much to my surprise and relief, there was my little 3-year-old, looking as happy as ever, in my perplexed neighbor's arms. Because for the first 4.5 years of her life, Leslie had trouble digesting her food, she was not thriving. Concerned that, in spite of a voracious appetite, she gained very little weight and was much too small for her age, we treated her for every conceivable allergy on the planet. We took her off all dairy products, put her on soy formula, removed gluten, sugar, salt, and fat from her diet. Since nothing we tried seemed to make much of a difference, we simply decided to let her eat anything she wanted and do our best to help her enjoy life. The dark night of the soul comes just before revelation. When everything is lost and all seems like darkness, then comes the new life and all that is needed. Joseph Campbell. Chapter 3. Sadly, the stress caused by many sleepless nights, failed attempts at finding an adequate diet for Leslie, endless trips to the emergency room, the subsequent birth of her 2 brothers, Rusty and Tommy, plus the demands of my full-time teaching position, had left Russell and me with very little time to nurture our relationship. So even though we had been high school sweethearts, graduated from college together, and our college yearbook listed us as the couple most likely to succeed, our marriage ended in divorce when Leslie was 4, Rusty was 2, and Tommy was 5 months old. Shortly after the upheaval of the divorce, I called Leslie's pediatrician to schedule a pre-kindergarten physical for her and discovered, much to my chagrin, that he was retiring. Although I didn't like having to change pediatricians in what seemed like the middle of the stream, I scheduled an appointment with the young doctor who was taking over the practice. After examining Leslie and reviewing her medical history, the pediatrician asked if Leslie had ever been tested for cystic fibrosis, a chronic and often fatal lung disease. When I admitted to never having heard of cystic fibrosis, The doctor handed me all kinds of information about the catastrophic condition and suggested that I take Leslie to Children's Hospital in Los Angeles to be tested as soon as possible. That night, as I lay in bed reading the literature the doctor had given me, I felt utterly overwhelmed. Although I was unfamiliar with cystic fibrosis, I realized that Leslie had several of the symptoms that were listed there. One passage, which clearly explained Leslie's frequent problem with diarrhea and her voracious appetite, stood out. The gastrointestinal tract and the pancreas become blocked. The absorption of fats and certain vitamins slows down, starving the body of essential nutrients. For a fleeting moment, as I let the words sink in, my mind swirled with terrifying thoughts, like, could this be what is happening to Leslie? Frightened by the very idea that my little girl could have such a devastating condition, I dismissed those troubling thoughts and put them out of my mind. As the mother of three young children, taking a week off to go to Children's Hospital in Los Angeles was not going to be easy. Not only did I have to find a full-time babysitter for my three-year-old and one-year-old toddlers, but I had to prepare a week's lesson plans for my American literature and advanced Spanish classes. As it all turned out, finding a babysitter, making those lesson plans, and driving from Bakersfield to Los Angeles alone with Leslie was the easiest part of the entire ordeal. Leslie, who was extremely attached to me and to her brothers, had never spent a night away from her family, so I knew that I had to make the trip as enticing as possible. As we packed our bags and I talked about our upcoming adventure, Leslie asked, "Mommy, are the boys coming to Los Angeles with us?" "Leslie, this adventure is just for you and Mommy. Won't that be fun?" I replied. My daughter's next question was, "Will you stay with me at the hospital?" And of course, I assured her that I would. Although I had to move to a nearby motel for the rest of the week, I did sleep in her room that first night. After that, I arrived at the hospital each day early enough to have breakfast with her and remained there until she fell asleep at night. I had certainly dealt with dark nights of the soul before, but as I waited day after day to learn the outcome of Leslie's tests, I began to lose my conviction that they would prove her pediatrician wrong. It took 3 days to get all the results, and as time went on, feelings of fear and despair seemed to drape over me like a cold chill on a rainy night. Each day as I returned to her room, I would find my little extrovert busy telling some bedridden child a story or pushing a child in a wheelchair down the hall. By the third day, Leslie had made friends with everyone on her floor. She knew the names of most of the patients, doctors, and nurses, and everyone there seemed to know her as well. Just as it would one day be at Thornton Hospital in La Jolla and the USC Medical and Transplant Center in Los Angeles, Leslie endeared herself to the doctors, respiratory therapists, nurses, and hospital staff. Hearing stories about this compassionate, friendly little girl even compelled her pediatrician to show up every night in her room at bedtime just to say goodnight. After every conceivable test, the results were conclusive, and I was summoned to the pediatrician's office. Still in a state of denial, I knocked on his door and waited for him to invite me in. Before sitting down behind his large mahogany desk, the doctor offered me a chair. Noticing the anguished look on my face, the first thing he asked was, "Do you have any family or friends with you here in Los Angeles?" I told him that although I had family back home in Bakersfield, I was alone in Los Angeles. Then he asked, "Do you have anyone back home to lean on?" Instantly, my lifelong habit of never asking for help surfaced in my mind, and I inwardly asked myself the question, did I not ask for help because I really didn't believe that Leslie would be diagnosed with CF? Or was it because of my own issues around believing that I didn't need anyone but myself? After all, I did have three sisters, and I was certain that one of them would have been willing to accompany me to Los Angeles. Yet it had never occurred to me to ask one of them to be with me on this painful journey. Feeling overwhelmed with a deep sense of emptiness, I found it difficult to speak up. With my head hung low elbows resting on my knees and both hands on either side of my face. I shook my head from side to side. Then, choking back the tears, I answered the doctor's question with a very weak, "No." Unsure of the challenge ahead of me, I murmured almost under my breath, "I'm hoping the tests were negative." At that point, the pediatrician stepped from behind his large desk, pulled up a chair directly in front of me, and handed me the results of those dreaded tests. My first question after looking them over was, "Is there a cure?" With great compassion, he took my hands in his and, after a slight pause, said, "Leslie has an advanced case of cystic fibrosis, and there is no cure." "An advanced case? And there is no cure?" I whispered. Then, in a trembling voice, I continued, "How can that be possible?" The doctor assured me that Leslie had been tested twice because the only visible sign of the disease was the clubbing, a curving of the nails and the fingertips and toes. "If everything goes well for her, maybe she'll make it to age 7, he continued. As we both walked toward the door, he put his hand on my shoulder and added, "Take her home and make her happy and be sure and tell her teachers so that they will be especially kind to her." Then he shook my hand, and as he opened the door for me, he said, "It's all in God's hands now." In 1965, when Leslie was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis, neither her father nor I had ever heard of the mutated gene that both of us carried and had passed on to our child. So as I walked out of the doctor's office that day, my initial reaction to that prognosis was disbelief. I refused to believe that my child could have such a horrific disease. "No, no, no. I won't accept this. It can't be true," I uttered through trembling lips. Feeling desperate to see Leslie and just hold her in my arms, I headed down the corridor toward her room. I opened the door, peeked in, and noticed that she was not there. When the attending nurse told me that she was playing in another child's room, I actually felt grateful. I was not ready to face her. "Thank God," I whispered under my breath as I hurried down the hall toward the elevator. Once I reached the lobby, I headed directly for the front entrance and stepped outside. Paying no attention to the moving traffic, I ran across the street. The thought of losing my little girl had catapulted me into such a deep state of grief and depression that I lost all sense of reality. So once on the other side of the street, totally unaware of anyone walking beside me, with no inhibitions left, I found myself crying out loud. Many strangers on the street that night stopped and reached out to me, but as hard as they tried, none could dispel the agony that seemed to be tearing me apart. Still sobbing and emotionally out of control, I just hurried past them and continued walking from one street to another until I reached a sidewalk that was teeming with homeless people. Wrapped in blankets, trying to get through the cold, damp night, some were huddled together, encircled by their shopping carts, while others just sat outside of their cardboard houses. Much too upset to feel any danger, I was circling my way around them when a homeless man, sitting in front of his makeshift home, reached up, grabbed my hand, and offered to comfort me. "Are you okay, miss?" he asked as he gently held my hand. Frightened by his spontaneous gesture, I instinctively pulled my hand away and ran past him. The cold wind outside of me and the fog of unhappiness inside were relentless. Trying to find some inner relief and ward off the chill of that damp Los Angeles night that had me shivering, I wrapped my arms tightly around my upper body to no avail. Alone in that dark and frightening place, the person I missed most at that moment of inconsolable grief was my late father. In my delirium, I called out to him, "Papa, Papa, please help me. What am I going to do? I can't just let my baby girl die." I really don't remember how I got through that dark night of the soul, but what I do remember is that despite feeling totally desolate, I just kept on keeping on as I had always done. Freezing, mentally drained, and physically exhausted, I managed to find my motel. I stumbled through the door of that dingy motel room and laid on the bed with my coat still on, and much too exhausted to move, I fell sound asleep for over an hour. Abruptly awakened by an altercation outside my door, I jumped out of bed, ripped off my clothes, and stepped into the shower. The hot water running over my swollen face and down my weary back relaxed me enough to pull myself somewhat together, and I returned to the hospital to see Leslie. As usual, her pediatrician was in her room when I got there. Leslie, who never missed a detail when recapping her day, had his undivided attention. With absolutely no interruption on his part, he let her finish her story before saying, "Guess what, Leslie? You are going home tomorrow." Thrilled with the prospect of seeing Rusty and Tommy again, Leslie enthusiastically replied, "I can't wait to see my brothers. I have really missed them." The pediatrician smiled warmly and said, "I bet your brothers have missed you too." Then, as he always did, he kissed her on the forehead and said, "Good night, Leslie." But this time, before leaving her room, he turned to me and said, "Good luck." Early the next morning, I gathered Leslie's things and prepared to take her home. As I was packing the car for our trip home, my mind wandered back to my childhood, and I remembered how my dad had turned around a prognosis of lifelong paralysis due to his advanced case of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.